Under Iraqi law, the government wasn't allowed to sign contracts with foreign multinationals. And what they wanted to do was to legalize big oil being able to sign long-term contracts with the Iraqi government. And so, during the course of 2006, under pressure, under very heavy pressure, not just from the Bush administration, also from the British government, from the International Monetary Fund and others, an oil privatization law had been drafted in Iraq. And when Bush announced his surge, and the surge began in early 2007, one of its major aims was to get this oil law, which had been drafted, passed onto the statute books. And so, President Bush, he had a video conference with Prime Minister Maliki at least once a week during this period. And what he said, what dominated these video conferences, was Bush saying, when are you going to pass this oil law? When are you going to pass this oil law? Our patience is limited. When are you going to pass this oil law? And the same whenever members of the Bush cabinet met with senior Iraqi politicians. When are you going to pass the oil law? This was happening every couple of weeks. It was all they talked about. This week, quite boring. They talked about this, and at the same time, they started applying pressure in other ways. They said, well, if we don't get an oil law, then I think no more reconstruction funds for Iraq. No more aid for the US. And then, if we don't get an oil law, you know what those massive debts that Saddam Hussein incurred by the wars he fought and the palaces he built? Well, we're not going to reduce those. You, the Iraqi people, will have to pay all of them. And then, I'll tell you another thing, Mr. Maliki. If you don't get this oil law passed, we, the US military, are no longer going to be able to support your government. And Maliki knew very well that at that time, this government would only survive as long as it was propped up by the US military. And so effectively, it's a threat to remove you from this job. And they said, we'll set you a deadline. The deadline is September 2007. You get us the oil law by September 2007, you get it passed through Parliament, or you will face all of these consequences, which is called. So there was enormous pressure through the first half of 2007 to get this oil privatisation law passed onto the statute books. However, this is where things started to go wrong for the Bush administration. In December 2006, as David mentioned, I attended a meeting of the leaders of all of Iraq's trade union federations. There was about 18 or 20 of them. We were sitting around the table in Jordan. And we were talking about the oil law. We'd managed to get hold of a leaked copy of the draft text. We were talking about it. We talked about what it would mean for their members, the workforce, what it would mean for their communities, and what it would mean for their country. And they were furious. One of the Iraqi trade unionists, he said, we don't need thieves to drag us back to the Middle Ages. And so, for most of this meeting, they talked about how they were going to stop this. They decided they were going to fight this oil war. It was such bad news for the future of their country, they weren't going to let it happen. And so after this meeting, starting in early 2007, at the same time as Bush was announcing his surge, the Iraqi trade unions, they started organizing against the oil law that Bush was pushing. And what they did was they held public meetings, they held conferences, they published pamphlets, they held demonstrations, they told everyone they could think of about what was planned in this oil law. And Iraqis, remember, feel very strongly that their oil should remain in Iraqi hands. And this oil law proposed the opposite. And so the more it was talked about, the more other people wanted to talk about it. And the more people talked about it, the more people were against it. And this started spreading through the country. And all kinds of different organizations got involved in this campaign, all kinds of civil society organizations, many of the professionals who've been running the oil industry, they started speaking out publicly against this oil law. And this increased at the same time as the Bush administration was applying ever more pressure on the Iraqi politicians. Then something happened which was quite decisive. Members of the Iraqi parliament started to see, hang on, there's an enormous Iraqi popular campaign here, which is calling for one thing. We've got the US occupation calling for the other thing. Now, if we take that side, this is going to affect our future political careers. if we take that side, we can get one up on our rivals by making ourselves look like we're adopting a particular position. So starting around March 2007, members of the Iraqi parliament started taking this side. They started saying, we're against the oil war. And as they said it, that had a knock-on effect on their colleagues in the parliament, who saw a threat, oh no, we're on the wrong side here. And so, more and more members of the Iraqi parliament started opposing the oil war, out of political expediency. And what happened was, by that summer, in fact, a majority of the parliament was publicly opposing the oil law. And to get the oil law passed, it had to be approved by the parliament, but the parliament was now against it. The result was, September 2007 deadline came, and the law wasn't passed. It couldn't be passed because the parliament was against it. And today, in 2012, there is still no oil law in Iraq. Now, the reason there is no oil law in Iraq, the principal reason, is that Iraqis organized themselves and they talked about it. They told their members of their communities, their co-workers, their families, they told everyone they could think about this oil war. And they organized against it. And they succeeded. They succeeded in stopping the USA from achieving its number one objective in Iraq at the time, in spite of all this pressure that it was applying. In fact, this was the moment when US influence in Iraq started to decline, September 2007, because so much political capital had the Bush administration invested in trying to get this oil law passed, and then it failed. But it showed up the limitations of US power in Iraq. And in 2008, there were a number of occasions on which the US failed to get what it wanted because of this change. Now, I'm an activist in Britain. I get involved in these kind of campaigns. I have it easy in Britain. I don't have anyone threatening to kill me. I work for an organization as funding, as bank account. These trade unionists, their organizations are still illegal under this 1987 Saddam Hussein law, which was reaffirmed by Paul Grimm. They don't have bank accounts because their bank accounts have been seized by the government. And they were facing violence from every single direction. They were facing violence from the occupation forces. They were facing violence from the government forces. They were facing violence from sectarian militias and from criminal gangs as well. I thought it was hard to tell the difference. Those last three, just two. And yet, in spite of being in these most difficult of circumstances, they organized and they succeeded. And I can think of several occasions since 2003 in which Iraqi civil society has organized and has succeeded. That's just one particularly striking example. Anyway, I'll tell you a little bit about what's happening now and then I'll shut up. Discussion about it. I'd be happy to take your questions. In 2009, the Iraqi government decided it was going to sign 20-year contracts with big oil companies, regardless, even though they haven't got their oil. And so they signed them. They signed the first one, one of the biggest ones with BP, and then they signed one with Exxon, and then they signed one with the Italian company, Eni, and then they signed one with Shell. Then they signed a couple with Chinese companies, and then they signed another one with Shell. Since these companies arrived, you know, we were told that the arrival of these companies would clean up the Iraqi oil business, bring ethical Western practices. In fact, the opposite happened. Well, after they arrived a couple of years ago, corruption skyrocketed. And in fact, two of these companies are under criminal investigation over either payment or receipt of bribes on subcontracts. One of them, the Italian company Eni, is being prosecuted in the Italian courts, and the Australian company Leighton has been prosecuted in the Iraqi courts, both over payment or receipt of bribes. I haven't been in the business, they've made it a lot worse. But it's, you look at this, and it's tempting to say, well, maybe big oil got what they came for. Huge contracts, and maybe the US got what it came from. And I don't draw that conclusion. And the reason I don't draw that conclusion is because since they didn't get their oil law, these contracts are technically illegal. They have no basis in Iraqi law. They're invalid. And what that means is, since they've got invalid contracts, the contracts will last as long as The Iraqi government likes them. As long as there's an Iraqi government that wants the companies to keep operating them. The current Iraqi government does. But let's imagine in a few years' time there's an Iraqi government that cares a bit more about what Iraqis think or what Iraqis need. They could choose to change the terms of these contracts. They could even choose to tear them up. And the oil companies wouldn't have any legal recourse to go to international courts and say, please protect our contracts, because the contracts are illegal.